We're in Miller Canyon. Miller Canyon is along the 1915 Pleasant Valley earthquake rupture. And during that rupture, the ground went up about 2 meters here. And you can see the uplift of that 2 meters on my left in that small cliff. And that cliff dates back to 1915. Essentially, nothing has really happened to it. Behind me, along the cliff, there's been a small amount of erosion, and you no longer see that steep cliff. That's the alluvium that has come off of the scarp since 1915, making it more subdued. That process is the key to understanding and interpreting the past history of earthquakes when we excavate across the fault. And behind me on the right, there is a spoils pile from a ditch that we dug across the trench. And within that trench, we look at the structural and stratigraphic relationships that have resulted from repeated displacements like in 1915. So we're going to walk over to the trench here in a minute and take a look and show you what we see inside. We just moved over to the edge of the trench that we've excavated across the fault to try and reconstruct the history of earthquakes along this section of the fault. And when we say the history of the earthquakes, we're trying to figure out how big they were, when they occurred, and how frequently they occurred. And to that understanding is this process that we just mentioned of the downslope colluviation of material and the degradation of the scarp. And this is a very nice exposure between this dark contact and this darker material above and the redder material below. And this is the material that's come down since 1915. And every time there's an earthquake which lifts up the scarp, there's a package of material like this that develops between the earthquakes. So now we're going to go in the trench and try and find some of these older packages of colluvium that we can attribute to ancient earthquakes. I've moved down into the trench, and I'm going to attempt to show you the observations that point to the repetition of two large earthquakes prior to 1915. We were just up on the edge of the trench and we looked at the colluvium that was coming down from 1915, and I'm going to turn around and point up to where that colluvium is here. And it's almost up at the orange plate. And below the orange plate, there's this distinct line that comes down to me through here. That's the earthquake fault. And that earthquake fault is sheared. And that tells us that that material was there when the 1915 earthquake happened. In other words, if there was just air, there would be no shear. So we know that this material here was here before 1915. And this material is what we call massive. It's chaotic. There's no fabric. There's no layers. It is the material that collects at the base of a scarp as it degrades. So this package here is the colluvium that was shed off the scarp in an earthquake prior to 1915. Later, hopefully, we'll come back, or my colleague Paula will talk about how we actually ascertain the age of this deposit and when the earthquake occurred, but we're not at that stage yet. This package sits on top of these very distinct gravels that angle down in this direction. These were the ground surface at the time this earthquake occurred. These packages have actually been offset by yet another earthquake prior to the above one. And those are recorded in the same type of deposits below this gravel and these massive layers. So we're quite certain that we have two thick deposits of colluvium that have shed off the scarp in prior earthquakes, one extending from about here down to here, and another from here to here. And the thickness of the packages is a minimum estimate of how large the scarp was from which the sediment shed off the side, much like the recent sediment in 1915. So we're excited about this particular exposure. we think we'll be able to get a pretty nice earthquake history out of it, both in terms of the time and the size of the past earthquakes.